you know, I think you can, with all the social media and everything, you can skew something into being popular, whereas before people had to throw money down and buy it to you know, for them to quantify, okay, that's good, that's selling albums, where now it's all about clicks and bloody likes and follows and all this.
And so you can basically come and go.
Artificially create a band.
Yeah.
You know, they've been doing that for 10 years.
Got a massive, I know. Yeah. I'm old. I'm just catching on to this whole shit, you know.
Same here.
And sometimes that click doesn't even, like, because we experience that, don't we? Sometimes that click may be like 3 seconds of listening to it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And see some stuff coming out. And, like, even objectively speaking, if you close your eyes and listen to it, you go, yeah, no, that's just pure shit. How did that even get on the radio?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's just me getting old.
Smoko.
But I think that's always existed, though, Matty, hasn't it?
I think it's getting
but
worse.
But now,
it's getting
now
worse.
There's no filter. There's no filter.
Yeah.
I think that's the word everyone runs with.
I think
the filter.
You had to be of a certain quality to get broadcast out there. But now anyone could put anything on the internet.
Is the word dichotomy appropriate here? Because sometimes
define that word. Can you define the word?
Well, because on one hand, it does bring out talent that would never have been exposed otherwise. But then you've got all the shit that comes.
But that's the trauma and tragedy of being an artist. That should always remain. It should always remain.
Yeah.
You never. Well, there's a desperation in being an artist that is no longer exists. I still fucking feel it. Trust me.
Yeah.
Oh, 1,000,000%. Because every time I step on the stage, I feel a desperation that I have to. It's on me. It's on us. It's on what we do. That's a desperation. No one's backing me up. It all falls on me, you know, as an artist.
Mm.
And it's the same if someone picks up a brush. You don't get wankers picking up. They go, oh, please, I'm shit at this. Throw that thing away. I'm never touching paint ever again in my life. No, it doesn't get that because we all have a voice. We all think we have the right to be heard. Some people just shouldn't be heard.
Throw it away.
Throw it away. Forget it. You're shit.
Can I show you something that I saw today that I think is completely refreshing? I saw this thing and I couldn't believe how amazing it was. You guys might have to come in close. And it's worth it. Trust me. This thing has had 23 million, or it'd be more by now.
Is it Eddie Murphy doing James Brown? The hot tub! The hot tub!
23 million views in 2 days, right? But it's actually good. It's actually art. It's actually the greatest little bit. I'm only going to show you 40 seconds. Trust me, I can see your disbelief. You need to see it because from this moment on, it's chilling. It's actually frightening how well this guy, the song's called This Is America, right? Came out 2 days ago. Come in tight.
Right.
Trust me on this. 31 million views since I last looked at it.
Gee.
Jesus.
All right. I saw it without the hang with it for 40 seconds. Can you see that?
Yep.
That's how I dance after I drank the rider.
This is America.
That was nice.
I don't know if you could see that well.
That is amazing.
When I saw that and went, that's amazing. It's like the new Thriller to me. Like something that...
Who is that?
Childish Gambino, who I know nothing about. But I saw that today. It was from Dean Del Rey, like a rock musician, big old guy, went, this is the craziest art I've ever seen. It's the best thing ever. And it's all about, I don't know, this is America. The gun debate and all that sort of yada yada. But it actually made me feel refreshed. Like someone's... I don't know if you could see that too well. Could you?
Yeah.
I can see it.
It's like, I just went, oh my God, they did it perfectly. He did it to have like a chorus of singers and then he all of a sudden just like, executes them. But he's smiling so like, yeah.
This is America.
Damn.
I like how there's no breaks in it.
Oh yeah, that. The whole thing, it ends up with him running like with the greatest fear in his eyes and everyone's chasing him down the hall. Like he's just done all this horrific shit and... But you actually feel the fear and then boom, it ends. I'm like, oh my God. 31 million views, right, in 2 days. And everyone's saying the same sort of thing. This is amazing. Anyway, I can't recall why I brought that up, but...
Because of art.
Speaking of art, yeah, like...
About social media.
If anything, that's refreshing to me. Someone's sort of like putting the brakes on. How about this, you know? It makes everything else look a bit silly for a little while. Someone can get hold of it.
Yeah.
Tell me a story.
It's very heavy. Tell you a story.
Oh, okay. So can I ask a question then? Sorry, I always do this, don't I? I go back 30 minutes ago. So because I was talking about, I was asking you about how, you know, like maybe how do you do what you love doing and still get the audience to come and watch you, right? Because Drew's band seems to... Will you conform to what the venues want you to do?
No, we just got to try and get girls dancing and people drinking. So that makes
and
the venues happy.
And 80s music does that? Because I would have thought that 90s music and, and alternative music... Because isn't there an audience for alternative music? Because I love alternative.
See, I reckon one of the things that's happening now is that people used to go to the pub and they'd want to go and play some Barnsley.
Yeah.
Whereas those people have stopped coming to the pubs now, and the people that actually like this music, their kids are old enough that they stay at home, so they can go out to the pub again and they want to hear this sort of music. Yeah. And like as much as I was criticising social media before, Mikey flogs the hell out of our social media page and does an amazing job of it and is finding these people and, you know, getting it out there that this is on. And people are, we've got this gig coming up and people come from bloody Melbourne.
Yeah.
Potentially changing the culture of these people that are going to our cover gigs.
Yeah.
Because rather than...
It's a good thing.
Because you guys are going to a place where the people are, whereas what we're putting a gig on and people are coming to that.
Yeah.
Which is... And it's sort of... It's creating sort of something, a bit of a niche sort of a thing with what we're looking... You know, with what we're doing. So that's sort of, I think, is the main difference. Yeah. I've played in cover bands, God, since I was 17, for years. And, you know, as much as everyone shit cans... cover bands, and I have a crack at it every now and then myself, but I'm the biggest whore of a cover band person that's ever been. But, you know, you go into these things and, you know, I know some great artists that only play original music and they get to play 3 gigs a year where I get to play bloody 4 gigs a week.
Yeah.
So when it comes to perfecting your musicianship, not that I've done that, but, you know, experience, being on stage, getting your ear right. And so when it comes to something like this, you know, they'll play a song. We go, okay, yeah, we know how that goes. We know how to get that to sound right. We know how to set everything up to do that. And you can, and it just gives you all that experience you know, how many gigs would you have played in your life, Mike? Bloody thousands where, you know, some of these really good originals bands might and play bloody one a month.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you want to get out there and make some noise, which is, that's what I'm all about. I'm just, I'm not too caught up on the art of it all. I just like making a freaking noise.
That's so true.
But it's so much better making that. I'll go out and make a noise. It's so much better making that noise, playing the songs that you want to play, than playing the songs that you feel you have to play.
Blister in the Sun and all that crap anymore. So.
I mean, so am I, but I still do it every week, which sucks. But that's what Outshine's for. That's what we've got this for.
But you seem to have found a balance where you've got the band
very,
that you
very
do.
Very lucky, very thankful.
Yeah.
A few projects that allow me to
have a
hand in each.
Yeah.
Which is, lucky.
You definitely have to have the intelligence, though, to Like, I've been in bands before where dude just wanted to play Cream and blues rock. I'm like, dude, there's just no one coming. Like, you know, you could keep going down that path forever playing death metal. You know? You have to still have some intelligence with you lads. You're like, come on, we still want to...
Well, again, it's touches...
We timed it right. Come on.
Yeah, but it also, we touched... Like, gets back to what I touched on earlier. We've all known each other for 20 years. So we've got that... We all play. We've all got that wealth of experience from 30 years of playing music. But then we've also spent time in bands together with each other in various acts. So to pull it all back together now into Outshined... Not only have we got that connection and an experience, like, we've got each other's backs 100% of the time. Like, when it comes down to discussing anything within the band, everyone's opinion is valid, song list is valid, the run order is valid, budget is... Everything is just discussed fully between each member, and nothing goes ahead without everyone knowing about it.
Yeah.
Song list is the easy part. Or getting people to the gigs is because what Matty touched on, people want to come and see that. We're putting it out. We're just putting our dates up.
Yeah.
Getting back to the social media part of it with the page, we've got, there's a few, there's, you know, there's probably 20 or 30 people that I know of just by name through running the page.
Yeah.
They contacted, private messaged, they've been to 5 and 6 shows. We've only played, like, I think the one in Byron next week is show number 9.
Mm. Yeah, it wouldn't even be double figures.
No, it wouldn't even be double figures yet. It's like number 9. But we've got people that... And groups of people that have been to 5 and 6 shows.
But yeah, well, that's what I was saying, like, earlier. Like, do you think there's somewhere out there there's... the audience is being underestimated, as in, like, oh, if we don't play Mustang Sally or...
it comes down...
The sun,
look, it comes
we
down... Well, look, it comes down to the venue because, like, I play Twin Towns in the covers band.
Yeah.
And I also play the Beer Garden. And you wouldn't play Mustang... Like, you'd play Mustang Sally at Twin Towns, sure, but you wouldn't play that at somewhere like Brodie Lies Bar or at the Beer Garden.
No.
You've got to be very... Your set list's got to reflect the people that, you, that are in the crowd.
What do you think of... Because I've been gunning for a band that does just all Aussie music. Because I think Australian music... Well, where are they?
We've done that for gigs before, for the agency that I work for.
Why can't we do?
They've needed... Wasn't there Australian Made?
Australian Made, yeah. Andy was in that.
Yeah.
Because I think Australia...
So someone goes, play the gambler!
Yeah. Exactly.
No, but Australia has produced so much good music, like, and especially before... You know, like back in the
countdown. Yeah, there's been a couple of Ozmade. There's a couple of Ozmade tribute shows going around.
Are there? Why do I not know of these bands?
All right, Rollerball.
Yeah.
What was a big tour that you recall? You know, give us some... Let's give us some... I'm really interested
some
in
road
that.
Stories, man.
Because you have to acknowledge that you're in that cool era.
But wait, before
where you
that...
you get away
that,
with things and do...
Before that, how do they know each other? How do you all know each other?
Music.
And Janet. Then go into then go into Drew's story.
I have played music with Anthony, Mr. Blaise Lee, and that was one of those incarnations, Blaise, where we were playing Blink-182 and shit like that.
Yeah, we'll do
it. And I got
some.
Bored real fucking quick.
So do I.
And just too much drinking because it's like, oh my God, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to have to get really drunk to sing this sort of music. So that didn't last long.
No, it didn't.
Matty, I've only genuinely met Matty Rowe through this. Yeah, but we know people that know one another, and I'm surprised we haven't bumped into one another.
I'm only in this because a singer at a Rollerball's in it, and I'm a bit of a greedy.
Yeah. And yeah, like I said, Mikey and I, he's one of the first lads I met when I came to the coast, one of a select handful of people that have been genuine friends since then. So yeah, that's where that is. So we all do hang in the same realm. They're original sort of Queensland boys here. Well, not really. Tasmania.
No. Hobart.
Tassie.
I met Blaise and I were actually, like, I joined Remedy, my covers band, in 1991.
Was it Blaise?
Yeah, and Blaise was already in that band.
Well, really? Remedy, 1991?
And I wasn't even on the coast then.
Far out, man. Talk about I'm alive.
Yeah. Yep.
Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Yes.
91. Yeah, it all happened.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, we were playing a lot of that stuff.
We had Chili Peppers in there.
Yeah, Pearl Jam. Like that's
all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, we were doing...
I like poetry.
That was the first time
Mikey, what guitar shop do you go to? Where do you get all your strings and all that?
The one where Blaze works.
Yeah.
Blaze,
what's this?
Guitar World.